Of course, for those of you who have not seen the news in the past day, yes, we did believe persistent storage requirements were needed too. And yes, I'll be talking about it towards the end about the relationship between, let's say, databases and Amazon EC2 and how you can use these kind of technologies. But first, now, look at it at Amazon scale. This is the kind of numbers that you should keep in mind when you think about Amazon. And some of those numbers you may not know. Now, there's about 1.3 million individual sellers selling on Amazon, which accounts for about almost 30% of the sales that are going on Amazon. Yeah. 30 fulfillment centers, which is about 12 million square foot, and about 4 million shipments during the big day last year. Now, Amazon in the past 12 years has gone through quite a bit of a transition. Now, we used to be single seller, that's how things started out. Now we have way over a million sellers on the platform. We used to be a technology consumer, but now we're a technology provider. Yeah, and most of these things, if you're a technology, you've already heard about. You know, we used to be just a website, we're now providing web services. And in essence, we were enterprise scale, but we moved way past that to, I think, what's called web scale. And I'll define that later. Yes, I want you to think about that Amazon has not just you as a retail customer, but there's a whole set of other customers that we consider and that we're just as passionate about. So those are the folks that are actually selling on the Amazon platform. They may be very big, like electronic companies such as JMR, but they may be small mom-and-pop shops just selling a few books. Then there are the enterprise services companies such as Target, Marks & Spencer, BB, very large e-commerce operations that actually run on Amazon Enterprise Services. There's the Amazon e-commerce web service customers. We used to call them associates, but these, together with the Amazon e-commerce web services, they build kind of innovative applications that drive traffic towards the Amazon site. These folks do what I call data integration. That the original Amazon Web Services, although they were web services, they allowed you access to data that lives inside the Amazon platform. And of course then, now there's the next big group of developers that we're targeting, and there's about 330,000 of them at this moment that use the infrastructure web services. And that's where we'll be talking most about. So I'll try to do this by doing sort of a history story of Amazon, not too detailed, but this was the first website that Amazon ran. Anybody ordered on this website? Can see hands. Oh, am I really the oldest person in the room? This is only 12 years ago. Remember that my kids cannot remember a world without Amazon. For us, or at least for me, this is still all very new and very, you know, engaging and a new technology. For many other worlds, you know, this is default. The reason why Jeff actually started Amazon was not because he thought that just doing business on the web was a cool thing, or just that he was a big book lover, although he really liked books, but that you could start a meaningful business on the web in a way that you couldn't do with brick and mortar stores. There are so many books out there that it's almost impossible to print a catalog. Yeah, and if you would ship the catalog, it would be immediately out of date. So selling books online really made sense because you could add something to the experience. Now this is very short, the history of Amazon technology. Starting off as being an application server and a database. And then moving towards around 2000, 2001, towards service orientation. And that was way before service orientation was a buzzword. And we'll get to what exactly that means for Amazon. 2-3 years later, we're kind of growing much more, and we're getting more experience with how to run services internally. And we're slowly moving to this massively scalable distributed system, and that is really based upon services. So the timeline about this is databases and app servers until 2000-2001, and in 2003-2004 we really made the switch to the next generation. Now the first 5-6 years, let's say up to 2001, every year was a year of how to grow the database. In January, after the holiday season, where with duct tape and WD-40, kind of the whole database was kept alive, engineers would get together and, you know, wipe their brows and say, how in heaven's sake are we going to go from this year? Splitting off tables, adding databases, buying mainframes at one moment, nothing helped. Every year, again, was a duct tape year, until we moved to the service orientation piece. Now, we were helped by sort of fortune. In around 2001, the app server that we were using, and if you remember those URLs, that actually had this word in it called Óbidos, which is a small town on the Amazon River, was actually the name of the app server. We couldn't build that app server anymore. The first years, we had taken this approach called Get Big Fast, and part of that, every architectural principle was allowed to be broken, which we did. And that came back to haunt us around 2000-2001, where we were forced to look at what we were doing and why we couldn't scale anymore. Now the big thing was, there was this one monolithic application talking to this whole range of databases. And so we made the decision that, given that this couldn't scale anymore, what was it that we really needed to do? So all the business logic was sitting in this one app, the data was written somewhere else. And we decided to move the data business and actually move it towards where the data lives. So we scaled this application server and all the data that we had, moved all the business logic towards the individual data items. And there was no direct database access allowed anymore. The only thing that you could access the data was through the business logic that actually operated on the data. So then we end up, you know, with a rather large environment, many services. At the moment we're close to 1,000. That is a platform on which all these individual pieces of technologies work. This actually is a snapshot of a tool that we use to investigate the page and see what the dependencies are. So at this moment, if you hit the gateway page of Amazon, it will go out to somewhere between 250 and 300 different services to create this page for you. And we use the mechanism of services also to drive innovation, because it's easy to start up small teams to build those services. Of course, after a number of years of running this environment, you start to learn lessons. And we thought that this will be a very flat organization, and a very flat software organization all contributing to pages. It turns out this is not the case. Now there's a number of large services that you would call foundation services that hold the major data sets that Amazon relies on. For example, customers, items, offers, things like that, that are in general used as sort of primary keys into accessing the other services. Yeah, so the other services function as aggregators. They build additional value upon the basic data stores or the data services that are in the foundational layer. Now, given that we've been running this sort of services organization for a very long time, we were great believers in this particular model. The model being that you would move from actually shipping software to providing services. This is actually a ripoff of a marketing slide that I found somewhere, where these folks are really big believers. You know, there's the old cycle, the old model is, you know, you have to develop, you have to test, you have to wait until you have a release ready, then you bring your CDs, you ship it out to your customers, and then there's a bug. Which means you have to go through a new Q&A cycle, burn new CDs, send new CDs to your customers, and you go through this virtuous cycle. And the great promise of software as a service but there's only one fix needed, and immediately we can provide this new service to you. So there's this wonderful land at the bottom called software as a service that seems to be truly nirvana for every software producer. It is a big lie. This is an elephant in the room, and if you can find it. If you really want to do software as a service, this is this cycle. There's that, you know, develop, test, bang, you deploy it, and you operate it. And remember that the companies that move into software as a service are all traditional software companies. Suddenly, when they start doing this, they find that there is a sort of a hidden big red box in there that they had never heard of before. What do you mean I have to configure my routers? What do you mean disks fail? What do you mean BGP is not really stable? Do I really have to configure load balancers? What is it? How expensive are those load balancers? So there's a whole list of things suddenly where you have to become an expert in if you want to do software as a service. Yeah, before this, you didn't need this expertise. Before this, you just needed to develop software, and you needed a CD burner, or maybe an FTP sign, and that was sufficient. Software as a service comes with a very big cost that you have to address, and we internally noticed this. Yeah, because we were the big believers in service orientation. We went there, and we actually organized Amazon internally according to those services. Each team, each service has a team associated with it that not only builds it, the service, maintains it, but also actually runs it. And there's some great advantages to it. You know, there's no bigger motivator to fixing your software than your beeper going off at 4 a.m. in the morning. Yeah? This cycle of, you know, one bug, one fix, goes very fast if it actually is due and is feeling the pain that the customers are getting experienced. But when we started looking at the overall architecture, it was pretty clear that everybody was going through the same thing. So if you look at all of my different teams, and there's about 1,000 services now at Amazon, all of those teams were spending the majority of their time configuring routers, deploying software, managing load balancers, all of these kind of things, and the worst thing that they were becoming experts in it. But they were not contributing to the next generation of recommendations. They were becoming experts in managing very large scale environments. And as much as that, that's a great new skill to learn, that's not where you want to have your investment in. So these are kind of the few examples of stuff that you run into if you want to enter the software as a service market. Yeah? This is an AT&T data center out there in Florida. And if you thought that your data was secure, this is a hit by a tornado. For some reason, we tend to put data centers in the same place where we put trailer parks. And they attract tornadoes. But if you thought that your data will be safe and sound when you woke up that morning, it is gone. So at Amazon, you know, we expect our data centers to fail. Hopefully not in this particular mode, but we expect them to fail. And we also expect our software to tolerate these kind of failures. And tolerate in a way that the customer is not affected. We have the rule that we should be able to lose one data center without the SLA to the customer being violated. And this is a latency SLA. C65 Main in downtown San Francisco, and I don't want to bash these guys, this is really one of the top data centers in the world, very well provisioned, 8 diesel generators. They start them every week. They test them. Yeah. And of course, downtown San Francisco gets hit with a power outage, and ironically, the lights are still on in this picture. But what really happened is that the moment the power went off, they started up their diesel generators, and at that moment, 6 of the 8 generators failed. And it's not their fault. You know, they did all the right things all along, but some act of God, or whatever you want to call it, they lost 6 of their 8 generators. And most of Web 2.0 was actually offline for those few hours. Of course, it's wrong to assume that you would be able, that you should live in only one data center, but that's another, that's a whole different discussion. If you look at reliability of disks, this is a study by the Google guys. They measured the life expectancy of their disks and found that about 10%, between 8 and 10% of your disks will fail per year. And if you have a medium-sized data center, let's say 20,000 servers, put 4 disks in each server, so you've got 80,000 disks, 10% of those will fail, 8,000 disks a year will fail. You will have people working in that data center doing nothing else but replacing disks every day. And then we have to think about all the other stuff, Well, if you become successful, can you deal with that? You have to make massive investments up front. Or even if you are already successful, these are the traffic graphs of Target.com and Walmart.com. I'm not putting them up just to show them that they have, that they're about equal in terms of traffic. I didn't put Amazon up there because then you couldn't see their graphs anymore. But the big thing is that actually the traffic spikes for these sites in the holiday season is about 2x their normal traffic. So what do? You buy 2x the servers just so you can manage your traffic during the holiday season? What do you do with them the rest of the year? And even internally in Amazon, remember we've chosen for the services model which gives you fairly coarse grain isolation. And that means that resources are associated with those services and they are not shared. But these are the 37 signals guys. They wrote a great book. It's called Getting Real. It's all about creating a startup. There is in chapter 4 one line that says, don't scale. Don't build software for scaling. And you know why? Because it's too hard to do. Focus on what you really can contribute as a small company in terms of your unique value versus trying to work on scaling your site. Now, of course, if you look at this, we have all these services out there, and each of these services has a team. So Amazon was wasting quite a bit. We were spending all of this time and money on people managing data center failures, which we, by the way, exercise multiple times a year. We just bring data centers down just to show to ourselves that actually our software can survive. So we went through what I consider to actually to be a traditional enterprise consolidation phase. First of all, you move fast, you have all these individual pieces, and you look at the pieces that actually everybody needs to bring together. What is it that everybody uses? So we went to a services orientation that hit all of the infrastructure pieces. We virtualized the disks, the network, most of the middleware software, all of these kind of pieces. And I actually used this picture here as a courtesy to our hosts today. You'll see that there is actually certain hardware sitting behind this picture. But the key thing is that as a user, infrastructure should be infinite. You shouldn't want to worry about where your infrastructure comes from. We at Amazon arrived at a set of small services that actually could manage most of the internal infrastructure needs. So by now we know which those are. There's the storage service as S3 and database server SimpleDB. Then there is compute power by EC2, computing, and FPS is our payment service. And these are the traditional marketing words that go with. Most importantly, and I'll come back to that in a little bit, is that you can increase and decrease capacity at on demand. Now, this is where everybody ends up. So now suddenly, if you use these services, you get your head the cloud. Now, the only thing you have to worry about is your own, you know, your own business model. Huh? This is where the sales presentation starts. Yeah? So let's talk a bit about what's really the technology behind this and some of the lessons that we've learned over time from this. These are what I consider four non-functional properties of our system. Yeah, let's talk a bit about this too. This is the Amazon business model. Just like any other company, we're interested in growth. How do we do that? We make sure we have the largest selection on earth. Gets customers to our site, we drive prices down, gets more customers to our site, more traffic means more people want to sell on Amazon, which drives again the selection. Now you say, get this sort of flywheel going that drives growth in your company. Which in general means you can get to a lower cost structure, and on Amazon we decide that the lower cost structure immediately results in lower prices, so you feed that flywheel even more. Now why am I telling you this if we want to talk about technology? Yeah, because it means that incremental scalability is key to Amazon's business. If you really need to grow, like Amazon is doing, you need to be able to grow one step at a time continuously. Yeah, you need to turn something that was considered to be fixed cost into a variable cost, into something that really grows as your business grows seamlessly. But most importantly there is also, it's not just growing. Scaling doesn't mean growing up or growing out. It also means getting small. Essential in these services is that not only that you can actually allocate them, but that you can release them. What you see in the older model, where we had this big services model, coarse grain, people would get 40 servers for their model, for their service, 40 servers for their service. And they would only need 30, but they wouldn't release the additional 10, because they would never know whether or not they would get them back. There was so much uncertainty in the whole picture that they would be hoarding resources. So it's essential that you make it easy to release resources and acquire them again if you really want to build a scalable system. And of all of these lists, one of the things that I actually want to point out is heterogeneity. Do not believe that all of your nodes will be of the same capacity. Now, half a year from now, you'll buy a whole set of new servers, add those to your software stack, and actually you'll find that they run twice as fast. If your software can't deal with that, if they really require the system to be homogeneous in terms of capacity, you do not have a scalable system. Well, availability, well, we really talked a bit about data center failures and things like that, but believe me, everything fails all the time. And it's not because at Amazon we buy cheap hardware, we actually don't. But at our scale, things continuously fail always. Whether it's from the smallest components, from memory chips, all the way up to complete racks of nodes, areas of data centers, whole data centers going down. And that's just the hardware side of things. Yeah? Then we run on the operating system, which isn't always as reliable as that we would want it. And we have middleware pieces that actually fail quite a bit also. So we treat the layer almost above the database as everything that sits underneath there as completely unreliable. And build our own software on top of that such that we have complete control over the reliability. Now there are two things always that are kind of cited in the literature. If you look at algorithms, yeah, one way that you can evaluate whether algorithms are suitable for real life or not is how they deal with failures. And many take statements like failures are not correlated. Well, if you make that as an assumption into the algorithms that you build, they won't work in real life. Because believe me, failures are correlated in every possible worst way. Whole racks, data centers, everything will fail together. And if they fail, we must be happy that they won't continue to communicate. Because they won't fail by stopping. They will fail by sending out garbage. A new system must be able to deal with that, because otherwise, you'll go down the drain pretty quick. And one of the things in there is that we tend to create environments, smaller environments, where we think that we can control all the inputs and the outputs. Yeah? But believe me, determinism is an illusion. Yeah, it's an illusion created in a very small space. And you have to let go of this control of determinism. You have to start embracing more probabilistic techniques, because those really reflect real life. Performance. If you mention, if you say, well, the average performance to my customer is 200 milliseconds, what does that mean? It means that 50% of your customers are giving a worse experience. But that's really what average means, or median, sorry. Yeah? 50% of your customers is getting a worse experience. So it doesn't matter. You should not build your systems focusing on average or median performance. The only thing that really matters is performance at the end of the curve, at the 99.9% up. At Amazon, we religiously build our systems against the 3 9s. Because also we know that we often do a lot more work for our better customers, and they tend to shift towards the end of the performance curve. So it's really important to build your systems at that particular age. I like to believe that in school, as engineers, we're not really well trained in thinking about cost. And things now, these days, and the other speakers already have mentioned this, the world is shifting tremendously. You do not know whether your product is going to be successful or not. Where 10, 15 years ago, you may go through this sort of prediction cycle that is no longer exists now. Everything is more uncertain. So whether or not you need to acquire resources for this will drive how cost-effective you can be. You have to be able to acquire and release resources on demand. But most importantly, you only should pay for what you use. Never, ever pay again for things that are just sitting in your data center doing nothing for you. And if you look at all of these different non-functional requirements or non-functional properties, they are all dominated by the way that we manage state. Remember this picture? Yes, and it basically means that all of these services are managing their own state. Your reliability, your availability, your performance, all is based on how you manage your state. You can throw more computational resources at things, but if your state management system doesn't allow you to scale or isn't available, it doesn't matter. So we did an analysis at Amazon. We looked at all those different pieces before we started building those infrastructure services, about what are the different access patterns that all of these different pieces are using, and we came to a sort of this conclusion, that the majority, way more than the majority, of all data access in Amazon is primarily key-based. And you kind of really could determine that from the earlier architecture, you know, these big data sets that are actually key indices to smaller data sets. But the majority is all primary key-based. Now, often there are secondary keys and there are batch operators, but they're not in the high-performance part. But there are very high read services, for example. Updates always appear on the primary key part. They never appear on the secondary key part. Yeah. Second path is query-based access, but most of those are non-relational. So in the end, when we look at the whole Amazon architecture, there's only a very small piece of what we do that's actually relation-driven. So two of those services that we build addressed those needs within Amazon. S3 does primary key access. SimpleDB does query-based access. Yeah, and dedicated solutions are all those pieces that we couldn't figure out immediately by doing a large-scale service building ourselves, is to do persistent storage within EC2 and let other folks figure out how to build services there. How successful? Well, 14 billion objects by external customers in S3 early this year, so the growth is looking pretty good, and this is really not stopping anytime soon. How to build MySQL was something that was inside EC2, was something that was a big chore. The RadScale guys, from who I stole this this image, really had it down. They had done all sorts of tricks. They used the logical volume manager to actually run MySQL over and then extract those files, store them in S3, things like that. But one thing, and that was, it worked, but that was about it. Yeah, so one thing that I need to mention is we moved to a world with availability zones. I mean, we divided the world up into regions, and each of those regions with into zones where you could allocate resources, where those resources would fail independently. And within region you would have relatively low access to the other availability zones. Now, persistent storage in EC2 works like that. You can create a big volume, basically a massive hard disk that you can mount into your EC2 instance. And then you have a raw disk. And you can either use it from the database directly, or you can mount it, create a file system on it, or whatever you want to do. Creating, attaching those volumes to EC2, yeah, allows you to have infinite scalability in terms of your data disks. You can also easily detach them again, move them to different servers on the failure scenarios, things like that. You can also then actually point at those volumes and allow them to take a snapshot and store them in S3. And remember that S3 is worldwide. That means from those snapshots you can create new volumes in different availability zones. So let's run through a few examples here. Yeah, so if you, one of the common techniques used within EC2 is a sort of a recovery-oriented approach, where you do logging so that you can do fast restarts from disk. In this case, you have a volume, you store both log data and data there and log data there. If this instance fails or if you crash it, you can actually move it to another node, reattach it, read the log data, do a fast restart of your app. Yeah, this is another example within one availability zone. The database fails, the replication technique signals failure detection. The other instance mounts to the log, runs the redos, becomes the master, and you move the availability zone to, or you move the Elastic IP address to the new instance. But of course that's only, the previous technique only works within an availability zone, so this is how it works if you have multiple availability zones. Yeah, so here, each of those volumes are a periodic snapshotting into S3. Yeah, so if this instance fails, replication will signal failure. What will happen is that you create a new volume based on the snapshots that the old volume left behind, and you can turn the slave into a master. You move the IP address to the new instance, and you kill off the old log, and you start logging to that particular instance. So with this, it's now possible within EC2 to run any kind of data, what's this, middleware, database, and whether you build it new or whether it's legacy database, all of those can now be run within EC2, allowing you the greatest power to build your own applications. All you need is a credit card. Yeah? No, actually, so this is not really a joke, it's a story. I recently talked to the folks at Aragon Labs, and there was a professor there, and he told me a story that there was this student that came to him one morning, and she already delivered her homework. And he said, but how can you have this finished? You have no account on the national grid. Oh, she said, I just spent $5 at Amazon, and I just got my homework done. So even from everything, from supercomputing down to software testing, all these things can be run, and you never have to own any infrastructure again.